The Eternal Repose video series is a controversial topic subject to conjecture and debate. The opinions shared in these episodes are not the official doctrines of the Christian Church, but are my own opinions developed through research and thoughtful contemplation. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that each one may receive what is due him for the things done while in the body, whether good or bad. For we all must appear before the judgment seat of Christ. This is a scary thought. According to the Apostle Paul, a payment is coming our way from God, and we shall receive recompense for the things done while in the body. Should our deeds be seen by God as good, then we shall receive the just payment for our deeds. But should our lives be filled with evil, then we also shall receive the just payments for our deeds. This is divine justice. Let's stop and ask ourselves these questions. Is there such a thing as divine justice? Will our deeds be judged by God? These are hard questions to ask, because the answers are difficult to understand. Is there such a thing as divine justice? Is this idea of divine judgment only a Christian idea found in the Bible? The idea of fair play is a pervasive concept found in cultures around the world. Each culture might have a different opinion as to what constitutes justice and fair play, but a belief in a cosmic balancing of accounts clearly is seen. We all have seen the seemingly good person who played by the rules to be unjustly condemned, and we have also seen the apparent evil person escape the hand of human justice. Naturally, out of these scenes of injustice, the belief arose that the scales of justice will be balanced in the afterlife by a God of some sort. The one reoccurring theme in this video series is that heaven and hell are separate arms of the divine scale of justice. Let's take a walk through history and seek answers to these questions. Early Babylonian myths viewed death in a neutral context. Good or bad was not included in the equation. The power of the netherworld was its ability to imprison the dead, with no hope of returning to the land of the living. The Babylonian Epic of Gilgamesh was the first chronicled evidence of the existence of the netherworld, but this myth did not include a judgment of the dead and a balancing of the scales of divine justice. To the Babylonians of the 3rd millennium BC, The netherworld had no moral judgment associated with death. But this would not always be the case once the netherworld reached Egypt. Ancient Egypt was the first ancient society that codified a judicial procedure that took place after death. And both pharaohs and common men endured the same divine balancing of the scales. The pyramid texts of the 5th and 6th dynasty and the coffin texts of the Middle Kingdom both introduced the idea of divine morality and the deeds of the dead following into the afterlife. The Egyptian view of divine justice took a big leap during the New Kingdom era with the introduction of the Egyptian Book of the Dead. Judgment of the Dead stands out very clearly. The heart of the dead is put on a balance and weighed against the feather of truth. Should the heart fail the test, it is consumed by a crocodile-headed female demon named Emet, who was known as the Soul Eater. This is the first recorded instance of psychostasia, Greek for the weighing of the souls, that will be a reoccurring theme in the post-mortem judgment of the dead. The papyrus of Ani presented an interesting principle. Women were not judged in the same way as men. Women's lives were not put on the same plane as those of men. They were subject to the same fate as their husbands, without any thought given to their own deeds. The ancient Persian religion of Zoroastrianism has the idea of post-mortem divine justice. They believe that the scales of justice are found on the bridge of Requator. Each human soul must cross this bridge and face spiritual judgment. Should the soul be worthy of life, it is met by a sweet-smelling maiden who guides the soul onward to paradise, while the wicked soul is met at the bridge by a foul-smelling old hag who guides the soul until it falls off the bridge into the abyss of hell. In Greek mythology, we see the reoccurrence of psychostasia, the weighing of the souls. But it is unclear as how this idea is applied to the Greek afterlife. We see this event in Homer's Iliad, when Zeus weighed in the balance the lives of Achilles and Hector, who were engaged in mortal combat. It seems that psychostasia was used in Greek mythology more to determine the fate of combatants than judge the souls of the dead. In Greek mythology, the realm of the dead is Hades, and the deepest realm is Tartarus, the prison house of the damned. Through the writings of Homer and the Theogony of Hesiod, we have a clear linkage of Hades with the idea of punishment for our deeds. Greek philosophers and poets followed the Egyptians in the netherworld being a place of both rewards and punishments. But in order to have rewards and punishments, we must have a judgment process. In the 6th century BC, a secret cult arose around the poems of Orpheus, who insisted that the dead must rid themselves of the evil part of their nature by ritual and moral purification through a series of reincarnations. The devotees of this cult pronounced horrible curses and terrible suffering in the afterlife on those who rejected their concept of sacrifice. Some of the initiated into this cult believed that it was possible for the living to perform rituals that assist the souls in the afterlife. The philosopher Plato and Adimantes, Plato's brother, rejected these notions because it removed personal accountability from the immortal soul for the deeds done while alive. Plato wrote in his letters, "We must at all times give our unfeigned assent to the ancient and holy doctrines which warn us that our souls are immortal and they are judged, and that they suffer the severest punishments after our separation from the body." Plato also said in the Phaedo, "If death were a release from everything, it would be a boon for the wicked." According to Greek mythology, the netherworld had two possible destinations for the departed souls. The righteous departed would travel to the Isles of the Blessed to live in happiness, while the unjust are sentenced to Tartarus, the prison of the damned. Plato did make a distinction between the unjust. He described a judgment process where the curable unjust were purged and purified, then released, while the incurable are sentenced to eternal torment in Tartarus. The Romans believed that warriors, heroes, and those who died with honor would enjoy their rest in the fields of Elysium. The second destination was the plains of Asphodel, where good people lived as shades or ghosts, while Tartarus was the third and final realm reserved for the evil. The philosopher and poet Virgil, a close confidant to the Emperor Augustus, seemed to support Plato in his view of the netherworld. Virgil's underworld resembled Plato's, because both contained an area of judgment distinct between Elysium and Tartarus. The idea of a last judgment is difficult to track in the Rig Veda and Vedic periods of Indian history. The concept of a post-mortem judgment never fully developed in the myth and lore of India. But during the Vedic period, around the 6th century BC, evidence can be found of a belief in post-mortem rewards and punishments. The idea of a second death appeared in the Brahmanas, a collection of ancient Indian texts with commentaries on the four verdicts. As a penalty for those who failed to perform necessary rites and rituals, the idea of reliving the dying process caused some degree of fear, and this fear eventually led to the samsara tradition, the belief in reincarnation. From the root of the samsara tradition, the idea of the cosmic scales being balanced sprang forth. And this idea is called karma. Karma means deed, work, action, or right. Karma developed into a classic post-mortem reward and punishment system. Karma seems to function like a book that records our deeds, both good and bad. When we die, the scales are balanced and a new life begins based upon the verdict of these divine scales. From the Upanishad we read, those whose conduct has been good will quickly attain a good birth, the birth of a Brahmin, the birth of a Kshatriya, or the birth of a Vaisya, but those whose conduct has been evil will quickly attain an evil birth, the birth of a dog, the birth of a hog, or the birth of a Kandalaya. According to Hindu culture, karma is an impersonal force that determines the future of each person without the aid of divine intervention. In my opinion, this is not logical, because some form of intelligence must determine whether the deeds of each life is good or bad. Only a divine intelligence could make this cosmic decision. Let's not lose sight of a simple truth here. In order to have a system of post-mortem rewards and punishments, you must have a judgment process. All of these myths concerning the afterlife speak to a deep-seated belief in the immortality of the soul and the existence of a netherworld. From the Babylonians to the Greeks to the Hindus, the belief in a netherworld is a major part of their religions and myths. Even though these ancient societies developed extensive myths concerning the afterlife, these myths do not nullify the reality of the divine judgment of God. Maybe the ancients were more aware of the afterlife than we realize. How did the early Hebrew nation view death and the afterlife? It is generally maintained that the early Hebrews did not have a clearly defined belief in life after death, similar to the Egyptians and the Greeks, but they developed a belief in Sheol as a place for the dead. Sheol is also known in the Old Testament as the grave, hell, or the pit. Similar to the Mesopotamians, the early concept of Sheol was not seen as a realm of justice and punishment. It was morally neutral, seen only as the gloomy pit of the grave. Should this be true, then did the Hebrews believe in divine justice? The answer to this question is yes and no. The early Hebrews did not believe in the balancing of the scales of divine justice in the afterlife, but they did believe in divine justice and retribution in this present life. Isaiah wrote, "For the Lord has a day of vengeance, a year of retribution, to uphold Zion's cause." According to the Hebrew worldview, divine justice must take place in this life. Righteous acts reap righteous rewards, while wicked deeds produce undesirable consequences. The Hebrew prophets envisioned a coming day when God's divine justice is meted out to all unbelieving cities and nations. This future prophetic season was called the Day of the Lord. Isaiah and Joel referred to the day of the Lord as a day of destruction from the Almighty, a cruel day with wrath and fierce anger against all sinners. Ezekiel understood that the day of the Lord would be a time of great famine and doom for the nations of the earth, while Joel wrote that the sun will be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord. Obadiah described the day of the Lord as a time of recompense for the deeds we have done. Amos described the day of the Lord as a time of divine justice. He envisioned a season of great darkness on all those who rebelled against God. Zephaniah described the day of the Lord as a time when the jealous fire of God will consume the world and all life will be extinguished. All these prophets envisioned a coming time when God, in this life, will balance the scales of justice, when God will vindicate Israel. But this was not enough for the people of Israel. According to Hebrew doctrine, all the departed dead would fall into the shadow and gloom of Sheol, where disembodied souls have a conscious but dull and inactive existence. The Hebrew people initially regarded Sheol as morally neutral, where both the righteous and the unrighteous go at death. But the neutrality of Sheol caused confusion among the children of Israel. Why does Yahweh demand worship and loyalty, but treat us the same as the Gentiles at death? The Hebrew people began to have a problem. Israel was blessed as a community or punished as a community. Yahweh's judgment was communal in nature. The actions of a few can cause judgment to fall on the whole. Questions began to surface. Why does Yahweh decree such disasters against us? What wrong have we done? What sin have we committed against Yahweh? Why does the innocent have to suffer with the wicked? God seems to be an unjust God. Ezekiel the prophet sought an answer to these questions from God, and God answered. For every living soul belongs to me, the Father as well as the Son. Both alike belong to me. The soul who sins is the one who will die. The soul who sins is the one who will die. The Son will not share the guilt of the Father, nor will the Father share the guilt of the Son. The righteousness of the righteous man will be credited to him, and the wickedness of the wicked will be charged against him. Yet, O house of Israel, you say, the way of the Lord is not just, but I will judge each of you according to his own ways. God would no longer judge the nation for the sins of the few, nor would he judge future generations for the sins of their ancestors. The judgment of God seemed to shift from communal judgment to individual responsibility. Strange as it may seem, this answer did not solve the problem. If the suffering of an individual could no longer be connected to the sins of his or her ancestors, then how do we explain the obvious inequity in life? The assumption that Yahweh would reward the righteous and punish the wicked was being challenged by the obvious inequality of life. The righteous are not always rewarded, and the wicked are not always punished in this life. And at death, all souls go to the gloomy pit of Sheol. The way of Yahweh is not equal and just. Slowly, the idea of a post-mortem judgment developed in Israel. Both Isaiah and Ezekiel compartmentalized Sheol into levels reserved for the enemies of Israel. While Ezekiel also wrote that the shame of the dead would follow them into Sheol. In other words, our deeds do follow us, both good and bad, into the afterlife. The idea was now introduced that a final judgment would occur in the afterlife, and God would balance the scales. The idea of an afterlife that includes both rewards and punishments was also developed by Daniel the prophet, who divided the dead between the righteous and the unrighteous. The righteous would rise and shine as bright as the stars of heaven, while the unrighteous would suffer everlasting contempt. In order for this event to be fulfilled, a divine last judgment must occur. During the latter 3rd and early 2nd century BC, a series of pseudepigraphic works were written that were Jewish in origin. All of these works have features in common, but they all follow the book of Daniel in being visionary and prophetic. The most popular of these apocryphal works was the first book of Enoch that was written around 170 BC. This apocryphal work describes the journey of the Old Testament Enoch into the afterlife, where he learned the fates of both men and angels. He first witnessed a fiery abyss where the fallen angels are imprisoned forever. Then he visited Sheol, that was represented as a mountain, and Raphael, Enoch's guide, explained the significance of Sheol. Then Raphael, one of the holy angels who was with me, answered me and said to me, "These beautiful places are there so that the spirits, the souls of the dead, might be gathered into them. For them they were created, so that here they might gather the souls of the sons of men. And these places they were made, where they will keep them until the day of judgment, and until their appointed time, and that appointed time will be long, until the great judgment comes upon them." Clearly, the idea of Sheol had changed by the time this work was published. Sheol was now seen as a holding realm that would house the disembodied souls until the last judgment of God. The last judgment scenario described in the first chapter of this work is filled with death and destruction and peace and safety. One can only infer that the last judgment will be a balancing of God's divine scales. And the earth will sink, and everything that is on the earth will be destroyed. And there will be judgment upon all the righteous. But for the righteous he will make peace, and he will keep safe the chosen, and mercy will be upon them. They will all belong to God, and will prosper and be blessed, and the light of God will shine on them. This work also described the horror and confusion of the last judgment, seen through the eyes of unbelieving souls. Now, we realize that we ought to praise and bless the Lord of Kings, and the one who is King over all kings. And now, we long for a respite, but do not find it. We are driven off and do not obtain it, and the light has passed away from before us, and darkness will be our dwelling forever and ever. A monolithic change was coming to the universal understanding of the judgment of the dead, and that change would come from an itinerant preacher from the city of Nazareth. So often when we think of judgment, we think of a courtroom and a judge officiating over a legal proceeding being presented to the court. The duty of the judge is to ensure that all elements of the case is presented in accordance with the prevailing concept of jurisprudence. As true as this image may be, it is only a portion of the duties of a judge presented in the Old Testament. The image of a judge presented in the Old Testament is more about rule and government than the determination of guilt or innocence. The early Hebrew nation was governed by God-appointed judges who administered the Deuteronomic code established by God. The Hebrew judges were the government of early Israel. So, in a spiritual sense, judgment speaks of rule and government. This image is portrayed throughout the Old Testament. So, in a Judeo-Christian sense, the last judgment is more about the last rule and government established on this earth. Does the Christian view of the last judgment have a post-mortem balancing of the scales? I think it does, in a marginal sense. When we come to the New Testament, the day of the Lord is redefined as the day of Christ, the day of His coming in the glory of His Father. On 82 different occasions that span the four Gospels, Jesus used the title of the Son of Man to describe Himself. This is important because the reference to the Son of Man in the Old Testament is a messianic title. The prophet Daniel especially described the Son of Man as the Messiah that would be given authority, glory, and sovereign power over all people and nations of the earth. Daniel also described the kingdom of the Messiah as an everlasting dominion that will not pass away. The self-designation by Jesus that He is the Son of Man is quite frequent in the Gospels. And on 23 occasions, the title has a connection to the future coming of Jesus in judgment. Jesus said to them, I tell you the truth, at the renewal of all things, when the Son of Man sits on his glorious throne, you who have followed me will also sit on 12 thrones, judging the 12 tribes of Israel. No doubt, Jesus understood that he was the Messiah who would return to earth as both king and judge. Jesus also understood that God had given him this authority to judge. For as the Father has life in himself, so he has granted the Son to have life in himself, and he has given him authority to judge, because he is the Son of Man. As I said previously, the last judgment in the biblical sense is much more than the determination of guilt or innocence. It is rule and government. The very fact that God has given authority to Jesus to judge means that God the Father has established the last government upon the shoulders of his Son. In the Old Testament, this event was known as the Day of the Lord, while in the New Testament, it is known as the Day of Christ, the Second Coming, the Parousia. Jesus often used parables to teach the hidden truths concerning the last kingdom and judgment. In the parable of the wheat and tares, Jesus taught that the incarnation of the Son of Man would include two events. The first event was the incarnation of Jesus Christ and his sowing the seed of the kingdom, while the second event will be the second coming of Jesus in power and glory to set his kingdom in right order. The Son of Man will send out his angels, who will divide the world between the righteous and the evildoers. The righteous will shine like the sun, while the evil will be thrown into a fiery furnace. The very fact that there is a division indicates a last and final judgment. It is interesting to note the similarity between this parable and the vision of Daniel, where the righteous will shine like the brightness of the heavens. Christ taught another parable where he described the kingdom of heaven being like a fishing net that caught all kinds of fish. This parable also includes a final judgment and division, with the wicked being thrown into a fiery furnace. Jesus also used the parable of the 10 virgins to warn his followers of the need to keep watching for his second coming, because we do not know the day or the hour when this will happen. Christ used the parable of the talents to teach that in his future coming kingdom, even the righteous will endure a judgment process. Each servant of Christ will give account for the divine resources given. Even the righteous will go through a judgment process. Jesus understood that he would impose himself on human history one more time. He realized that Jerusalem would see his return in heavenly glory with all his angels. On two occasions, Matthew recorded the teachings of Jesus on this subject. Let's read. For the Son of Man is going to come in his Father's glory with his angels, and then he will reward each person according to what he has done. When the Son of Man comes in his glory, and all the angels with him, he will sit on his throne in heavenly glory. All the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate the people one from another as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. When Jesus returns, a judgment will occur, and a kingdom will be established on earth. The last judgment will be a time when all debts are paid, when each person will receive their pay, either good or bad. Matthew also reiterated that the last judgment will also include a division of nations based upon the judgments of Christ. According to the Bible, the last judgment does not have a predefined timetable. This would be logical when we factor in the government element in the last judgment. Jesus understood that the last judgment would include the establishment of a divine government upon the earth. Therefore, having the nations of the earth come before the throne of Christ would be logical. The Old Testament also described a future judgment when the nations of the earth would be required to bow before the throne of Christ. The fact that Jesus understood that he was the Son of Man indicates that he also realized that he would be the final arbiter judge at the last judgment. Paul expanded upon the last judgment scene taught by Jesus. He made it very clear that we must appear before the judgment seat of Christ. Let's read. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that each one may receive what is due him for the things done while in the body, whether good or bad. Paul wanted the Corinthian church to understand that all the saints, all the faithful, must appear before the judgment seat of Christ. When this day occurs, it will be payday, a time when all debts are settled, whether good or bad. Paul described the settling process in more detail when he wrote about our works being tried by fire. Let's read. For no one can lay any foundation other than the one already laid, which is Jesus Christ. If any man builds on this foundation, using gold, silver, costly stones, wood, hay, or straw, his work will be shown for what it is, because the day will bring it to light. It will be revealed with fire, and the fire will test the quality of each man's works. If what he has built survives, he will receive his reward. If it is burnt up, he will suffer loss. He himself will be saved, but only as one escaping through the flames. Paul wanted his readers to understand that during the last judgment, our works will be tried by fire as a test of each person's personal life. The personal judgment described by Paul is clearly a refinement process in preparation for entering his eternal presence. When do we think this sanctification process happens? Do we think God allows us to enter heaven unchanged? Do we think God allows us into heaven, but at the last judgment, we leave to endure the purification of our works by fire? This is not logical. The mercy of God would not allow such a thing. Our personal judgment must occur as we pass through the veil of Christ. I have often wondered where this purifying fire comes from. I have concluded that it must come from the eyes of our glorified Jesus. As we enter the veil of Christ, we must gaze into His glorified eyes that are filled with blazing fire. Our works are tried by fire when we embrace the gaze of Jesus in love. At that time, our true selves are exposed and our religious exterior is burnt away. Paul made it clear that all are saved, but all do not receive the same rewards. How long does this process take in human terms? I don't know. It is possible that the basic concept of purgatory is a description of our personal judgment and sanctification as we pass through the veil of Christ into the heavenly kingdom of God. Do we think sanctification stops once we die? Or do we continually grow in sanctification and holiness while in heaven? Just remember, without holiness, no one will see the Lord. Paul also admonished the Corinthian church that the saints of God would be involved in the judgment process. Do you not know that the saints will judge the world? And if you are to judge the world, are you not competent to judge trivial cases? The very fact that the saints of God are included in the judgment process indicates that we must be judged first. The fiery judgment presented by Paul in chapter 3 must be preparatory for our inclusion in the last judgment. This is why I said the last judgment has no clearly defined timetable. The Apostle John, in the book of Revelation, also described the last judgment in more detail. But the last judgment seems to incorporate two events that are separated by 1,000 years. It seems that both events include a resurrection. The first phase of the last judgment was for those who have died in Christ, and these resurrected saints will be priests of God and of Christ and will reign with Him 1,000 years. Remember what I said. Judgment also includes rule and government. We see that this facet of the last judgment establishes the millennial reign of Jesus Christ. The second half of the last judgment is more in keeping with the parables taught by Jesus. We see a great white throne and a book of life that will be used to judge the dead. The parables of Jesus included a removal of the tares from the wheat, the throwing away of the bad fish, and the separating of the nations between the sheep and the goats at the last judgment. It seems that the book of life will be used to divide the nations between the righteous and the wicked. We have walked through nearly 3,000 years of religious history, from the ancient Egyptians to the Christian faith. Nearly all religions and cultural myths have some form of post-mortem judgment. From the Egyptian scales of judgment with the feather of truth to John seeing the great white throne of God at the last judgment. Each of these cultures believe in a post-mortem judgment. Some clothe their view of divine judgment in myth and legend, while others maintain an element of truth, especially the Christian faith. Even though these cultures maintain a different belief structure with different application and result, there is one common thread binding these cultures together. They believe in a post-mortem judgment. Why would we see this basic common belief? The book of Ecclesiastes in the Old Testament makes a simple observation that brings clarity to this question. He has made everything suited to its time. Also, he has given human beings an awareness of eternity, but in such a way that we can't fully comprehend from beginning to end the things God does. God has put into the hearts of all humanity an awareness of eternity. This is why we see all cultures seeking the truth about eternity, because the deep is calling out to the deep. Eternity speaks to the human heart from the depths of our human soul. Will there be a last judgment? I firmly believe there will be, and the Bible is correct in its description. The same people who mock and ridicule the doctrine of hell also reject the idea of the last judgment. Just because you deny the truth of this event does not mean this event will not happen. Your denial does not alter God's divine justice. It is a dangerous thing to live your life as if there will be no divine judgment, because if you're wrong, then eternity is sealed for you, because if the Bible is correct, then you will receive what you have earned in this life, whether good or bad. Consider this thought with me. What great loss have I experienced living a life of faith? I have known pain and loss, but I also have experienced the peace found in Jesus Christ. The book of Proverbs explains this simple truth. For those who find me find life and receive favor from the Lord. But those who fail to find me harm themselves. All who hate me love death. Should you desire to find life and peace, then you must seek the face of Jesus. Joy and contentment can only be found in the life dedicated to Christ. Take a look at your life. Is it filled with harm and constantly difficult? Is it possible that you cause your own problems through your bad choices? Maybe your frustration is the result of not having Jesus in your life. Don't be surprised when you discover that those who hate Jesus also love death. Just be careful that their death does not find you. Don't deceive yourself. Freedom is not free. It always has a price, and it is a choice and a price we must pay on a daily basis. The American author Zig Ziglar said, "The chief cause of failure and unhappiness is trading what you want most for what you want now." What price will you pay for your freedom?